Now, special mention, those who want can lay on the table. Then it will be over. No other business? No other business? Those who want to read can also read. Today there is a...
Time hai.
Yeah. Those who want to read can also read. Sri Tarun Vijay? You want to lay or read?
No, sir. I'm reading it.
Reading it.
So the subject is need to have Indian Language Day observed and to introduce southern languages in the north. Sir, the glorious history of all Indian languages is unique and supremely great. We must work to develop feelings of appreciation and respect for each other. In this regard, it is necessary that people from North India be encouraged to learn any one southern language through a free choice option. For example, the incomparable golden heritage that we have in the form of Tamil should make every Indian proud. Tholakappiyam, approximately 5,000 years old, and on a broad spectrum, Shilapaddigaram, Chintamani, Manimekalai, Valayapati, and Gundala Keshi are great classics of Tamil literature. The onus of the greatest classic in Tamil literature undoubtedly goes to Kamba's Ramayanam, the epic poem, one of the greatest works in Tamil, which is widely praised even to this day, is Thiruvalluvar's Thirukkural. Its imprints are found in various parts of the globe. How many of us know about the global influence and public services of the great emperors like Chera, Chola, Pandya, kings? Only Ashoka and Vikramaditya are not India. Unless we have an all-encompassing respect for Cholas, Krishnadevarayas, and Pandyas also. Similarly, we have great history of Bangla, Malayalam, Telugu, and other Indian languages. I demand, observing Thiruvalluvar's birthday as glorious Indian Languages Day, in all parts of the country, symbolizing respect for all Indian languages and introducing Tamil also in North Indian schools as an optional subject for strengthening national unity. Palamayana Tamilamozi Vanagu Hiren. Thank you.
You have great supporters. Yes, very good. Please. All of you. Yeah. Very good. Thank you. Mr. K. N. Bal Gopal.
Thank you, sir.
You want
sir,
to
I'm reading
put it?
It I'm reading it. Academic and administrative intervention is needed for improving Kendriya Vidyalayas. Sir, a school run by the central government directly supposed and expected to be a role model to all schools in India. But in the case of Kendriya Vidyalayas, it is against these expectations. Through the Right to Education Act passed by the Government of India, it is the right of every children to get free education. But Kendriya Vidyalayas are collecting high fee from the students and it is doubled recently. The amount collected for Vidyalayas Vikas Nidhi needs proper audit. The fee hike is to be reversed. Many permanent teaching posts are lying vacant No proper training is provided to the temporary teachers. The transfer policy is inhuman. Presently, the teacher-student ratio in primary classes of state schools is 30:1, and higher classes is 35:1. But in some Kendriya Vidyalaya schools, it is more than 50:1. Sir, the long-pending demand to teach mother tongue as an additional language is not yet implemented. Academic atmosphere is pathetically deteriorated due to lack of intervals for food and basic needs, except 30 minutes lunch break. Long duration of morning assembly is conducted in the hot sun, under the hot sun. It is a fact that the children of Kendriya Vidyalayas of southern states, including Kerala, are forced to stand in the hot sun, under the hot sun every day to attend the assembly program for a continuous 20 minutes. The public is of the impression that the KVs are under the direct control of the central government and everything is properly managed. Therefore, nobody is interfering or scrutinizing the running of the KVs. Sir, hence, It is requested for a serious introspection over the total functioning of Kendriya Vidyalayas all over India.
Sir, but chairman is. Yeah, sir, one vice chairman is disturbing. All are associating, sir, this Kendriya Vidyalaya issue.
All of them, please. Yes, maybe associate, maybe taken up. Mr. Vijay Jawaharlal Dadda.
Thank you, sir. Sir, my special mention is on blood transfusion services. Blood transfusion services is the vital part of the modern healthcare system, without which efficient medical.
Come on, the loudspeaker.
Blood transfusion service. Blood transmission service is a vital part of modern healthcare system, without which efficient medical care is impossible. The aim should be to provide effective blood and components, which are as safe as possible and adequate to meet patients' need. The field of transfusion medicine has undergone tremendous changes in recent past due to the vast advance in this field. Accordingly, the Drug and Cosmetic Act, which governs this field, need revisions. Still, it gives license to old-time traditional whole human blood and very few blood components only. It should include latest safer blood components like leukodepleted blood components, etc. This law mandates screening of blood against TTI, transfusion-transmitted infections, like HIV 1 and 2, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, malaria, and syphilis by conventional methods. However, these government-approved conventional methods, rapid ELISA, do not. Rule of the possibility of infection of HIV, HBV, and SCV during transfusion. This is very dangerous for the public health in general. The prevalence of these infections in general population is about 3.5% and about 2.5% in blood donors. The latest NAT, nucleic acid amplification test technology, which is mandatory in many developed and developing countries, should also be mandated in India to make the blood near zero risk for the safety of public health. Many studies at various hospitals in India have shown that NAT dedicate around 5 to 10% infected blood units missed by the conventional methods. It detects 1 in 501,000 infections in donated blood units missed by government-approved conventional kit methods. And one unit of collected blood can infect 3 patients through components, red cells, plasma, and platelets. In view of this serious threat of transfusion, transmitted infections of deadly virus HIV, HBV, and SCV, the NAT testing of all collected blood units should be mandated in India. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, we'll take them on. Mr. Vyas Chaudhary, absent. Santus Kuzur, absent. Srimati Vansukh, CM. Shri Arvind Kumar Singh.
Haan, sir. Padhenge.
Aap table pe rakhna chahte hain ya padhna chahte hain?
Padhenge.
Padhiye.
Upadhyaksh Mahoday. उत्तर प्रदेश के गाजीपुर जनपद में स्थापित शासकीय अफीम एवं छारूद कारखाना में कार्यरत कर्मचारियों के कठिन परिश्रम के बल पर भारत सरकार को प्रतिवर्ष अरबों रुपयों की विदेशी आय प्राप्त होती है, लेकिन दुर्भाग्य है कि यहां कार्यरत कर्मचारियों को भारत सरकार के सभी कर्मचारियों की तुलना में वेतन कम मिलता है, जिसके कारण यहाँ के कर्मचारी मायूस रहते हैं। महोदय, मैं बताना चाहता हूं कि इस प्रतिष्ठान में सर्वप्रथम श्रमिकों की नियुक्ति सामयिक श्रमिक के रूप में होती है, जिन्हें 12 मास में केवल 6 मास ही कार्य प्रदान किया जाता है। यह प्रक्रिया लगभग 8 से 10 वर्षों तक लगातार चलती है, जिसके सापेक्ष सामयिक श्रमिकों को कोई लाभ नहीं मिलता है। यह कि 8 से 10 वर्ष तक सामयिक श्रमिकों के रूप में कार्य करने के उपरांत जब अस्थायी श्रमिक के लिए नियुक्ति प्रदान की जाती है, उस समय भारत सरकार के वेतन निर्धारण के नियम में जो सबसे न्यूनतम वेतन होता है उसी पर अस्थायी नियुक्ति दी जाती है, और न तो कर्मचारियों को सामयिक रूप में 8 से 10 वर्ष तक किए गए कार्यों का कोई फायदा मिलता है और न ही विभागीय पदोन्नति प्रदान की जाती है। यह कि इस प्रतिष्ठान में कच्ची अफीम की उत्पादन प्रक्रिया में बहुत ही खतरनाक रसायन प्रयोग में लाए जाते हैं, जिसके प्रभाव से कर्मचारियों की आयु आधी हो जाती है और समय से पूर्व उनका देहांत हो जाता है, किंतु इसके एवज में उन्हें कोई स्वास्थ्य वर्धक सुविधा नहीं दी जाती है। अतः महोदय, मैं सदन के माध्यम से सरकार से यह मांग करता हूं कि शासकीय अफीम एवं छारूत कारखाना गाजीपुर में कार्यरत कर्मचारियों को इस भीषण महंगाई को देखते हुए स्वास्थ्य भत्ता के रूप में लगभग 3,000 रुपये प्रतिमाह की धनराशि प्रदान की जानी चाहिए, जिससे कर्मचारी स्वास्थ्य वर्धक आहार ग्रहण कर सकें और लंबी आयु जी सकें। धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू। श्री भूपेंद्र सिंह।
वाइस चेयरमैन सर, द केबीके लॉन्ग टर्म एक्शन प्लान नीड्स टू बी एक्सटेंडेड फॉर कमिंग 15 ईयर्स इन द स्टेट ऑफ ओडिशा, which has been recognized as a special region by Government of India also. It is quite good that focus has been fixed to bring about all-round development in 8 districts comprising of as many as 80 blocks in the state of Odisha. The development schemes goes by the name KBK region. It is a joint development scheme run with the funds of the Union Government and supplemented by state funds categorized as State Biju KBK funds. It goes without saying that the focus on the development of the KBK region should not be shifted or sidetracked. The developmental action plan for the KBK region should go on with enhanced funds for another 15 years to ensure socio-economic development of the involving 3 undeveloped districts of K for Kalahandi, B for Balangir, and again K for Koraput. Thank you.
Thank you, Shri Parimal Nathwani. KP Ramba Lingam.
Sir, thank you, sir. My very important special mention to remove regional disparities in grass higher education enrollment ratio, sir. The Indian higher education sector has witnessed phenomenal growth during the last decade. There are 45 central universities situated in various states across the country. There are 312 state universities, 129 deemed universities, and 173 private universities. Thus, there are 659 universities to cater the needs of students who wish to pursue higher education in the country. A noble task of increasing the gross enrollment ratio in higher education to 30% by the year 2020 from the current 19% has been fixed. This is far below the world average, sir. It is pertinent to mention here that no Indian institution find any place in the global top 200 educational institution list. It is unfortunate to state that there are some regions in the country where gross enrollment ratio in higher education is below the national average. There are varied reasons for this. One among them is rural and urban division. The students from rural areas are lagging in many aspects comparing to their urban counterparts. Due to this, they hesitate and are unwilling to come forward to take up higher education. Besides this, there are gender disparities also, social discrimination and various other social factors which hamper the uniform enrollment in higher education across the country. In view of the above, I appeal to the government to take necessary steps to reduce regional disparity in gross enrollment ratio in higher education and ensure that there is uniform and equitable growth across the country, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Shri S. Thangavelu.
Thank you, sir. I wish to draw the attention to the this cause towards the direction issued by the central government asking state governments not giving the bonus farmers above the minimum support price announced by the central government. Sir, it is a general practice by the state government to announce excess amount in addition to the minimum support price announced by the central government. This is generally termed to bonus amount. This practice is extension for many years. And June 25th, the cabinet meeting in economic affairs on the recommendation of the Commission for the Agricultural Cost announced minimum support price MSPs for the kharif crops for the 2014 and 15 season. MSP for the rice has been fixed in the RS 1360. Sir, agriculturist, practical Delta agriculturist in the Tamil Nadu will be severely affected by the decision. Sir, due to the various reasons, agriculture has become unrecommendable, unable to withstand the high input cost. The number of farmers is dwindling. It will ever win the frequently incidents for the suicide of the farmers due to the Delta and crop failures. Under this in circumstance, this only the solution of the MSP given by the union government and its additional bonus given by the state government. If the central government remain firm its decision, then rice growers will be forced to sell in the private agencies, taking advantage these private buyers will exploit in the agriculturist in garner in essential food grains will become the harm. My party DMK leader Dr. Kalinger also deeply concerned over this. In this, my appeal to the government to revoke this decision and protect the farmers in country.
Thank you very much. Shri Veer Singh.
Mahoday, mere dwara vishesh ulekh ke madhyam se Muradabad Uttar Pradesh mein janhit mein do railway lineon par Sonakpur overbridge yojana banane ke sambandh mein hai. Mahoday, Muradabad shahar Uttar Pradesh mein aaye din jam lage rehne ke karan yahan ke logon ko kafi kathinaiyon ka samna karna padta hai. Yahan ke logon ko aagamon mein kafi pareshani hoti hai. उनकी इन परेशानियों को देखते हुए मुरादाबाद शहर में हरिद्वार रोड को दिल्ली रोड से जोड़ने हेतु 5 किलोमीटर लंबा बाईपास मुरादाबाद विकास प्राधिकरण द्वारा बनाया जा चुका है, जिसके बीच में दो रेलवे लाइनें आती हैं. उन रेलवे लाइनों पर सोनकपुर ओवरब्रिज योजना का प्रस्ताव उत्तर प्रदेश सरकार द्वारा पास हो चुका है. सोनकपुर ओवरब्रिज योजना पर लगभग 87 करोड़ रुपये की धनराशि खर्च होगी, जिस पर आधी धनराशि रेलवे विभाग खर्च करेगा तथा आधी धनराशि उत्तर प्रदेश सरकार द्वारा खर्च की जाएगी. उस धनराशि का प्रस्ताव उत्तर प्रदेश सरकार प्रस्ताव पास कर चुकी है. ऐसा प्रस्ताव उत्तर प्रदेश सरकार द्वारा भारत सरकार के रेल विभाग को दिनांक 20/6/2013 को भेजा जा चुका है. अतः मैं निवेदन करूँगा जनहित में उक्त कार्य को धनराशि उपलब्ध कराकर शीघ्र पूरा कराया जाए. धन्यवाद.
थैंक यू. Shri Paul Manoj Pandya.
Thank you, sir. I wish to bring to the notice of the House that the agriculturalists in the Tirunelveli district are dependent on the water released from the Pabanasam and Manimutha Dam. The water released from the Pabanasam Dam is released through the Nadiunni Channel, Kodagan Channel, Canadian Channel, Palayam Channel and the Nellai Channel. And as such, the people of Ambasamutram, Seranmadevi, Kaladai Kurchi, Veeravanallur, Koniur, Karukurchi, Pathamadai, Pudukudi, Melacheval and Gopalasamutram in Tirunelveli district and Tirunelveli and Palayam Kottai are benefited. The agriculturalists in the above area are solely dependent on the water released from the above channels. But hazardous plants that grow in the channels affect the purity of the water and also reduces the speed of the water to reach the tail end. The agriculturalists of the areas above mentioned are making constant requests for implementing cement lining schemes in the Nadiunni channel, in the Palayam channel and the channels mentioned above. Our Chief Minister Honorable Purachi Talavi Amma has implemented cement lining schemes in the Canadian channel. The agriculturalists of Alangulam, Ambasamutram, Palayangote and the entire Tirunelveli district are requesting for implementation of the cement lining schemes in the entire Tirunelveli district. In the above circumstances, I request the Honorable Minister to sanction special funds for implementation of cement lining schemes in all the channels of Tirunelveli district and thereafter in the entire state of Tamil Nadu, which provide water to the agriculturalists. I request the Minister for Water Resources to sanction special funds for the above projects. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Shri Lal Singh Vadodia.
Maniya Up Sabhapati Ji, Desh mein aise anek airport hai jahan pehle yatri jahaj ka aana jana hota tha, lekin ab band hai. Aisa hi ek airport Rajkot aur Junagadh ke beech Gujarat Rajya mein Keshod naam ka hai. जहां पर पहले नियमित हवाई जहाजों का आना जाना था लेकिन अब केवल चार्टर के लिए ही प्रयोग किया जा रहा है। यह एयरपोर्ट 50 साल से भी पुराना है और इस पर एयर ट्रैफिक कंट्रोल और बिल्डिंग की मरम्मत के पर प्रतिवर्ष करोड़ों रुपये का खर्च हो रहा है, पर यहां की जनता को इसका कोई लाभ नहीं मिल रहा है। केशोद एयरपोर्ट के पास के मात्र 40 किलोमीटर की दूरी पर गिर फॉरेस्ट है, जहां पर एशिया का सबसे बड़ा शेरों का रहने का स्थान है, और 40 किलोमीटर पर ही पृथ्वीराज चौहान द्वारा निर्मित 12 ज्योतिर्लिंगों में से एक की स्थापना सोमनाथ मंदिर है, जिसका जीर्णोद्धार हमारे परमप्रिय नेता श्री वल्लभ भाई पटेल सरदार साहब ने करवाया था। इसके पास ही धीरूभाई अंबानी का जन्मस्थल चोरवाड़ भी है। इन तीनों स्थानों के कारण यहाँ पर साल भर श्रद्धालुओं और पर्यटकों की भीड़ लगी रहती है। इसके अतिरिक्त यहाँ के लोगों को भी अनेक स्थानों पर आना जाना होता है। मेरे विचार से इस एयरपोर्ट पर पुनः यात्री हवाई जहाज़ों का आना जाना शुरू होना चाहिए। अतः मेरा नागर विमानन मंत्री से अनुरोध है कि वहाँ की जनता की मांग को देखते हुए इस एयरपोर्ट पर पुनः यात्री हवाई जहाजों का आना जाना नियमित रूप से प्रारंभ किया जाए, ताकि इसका लाभ वहाँ के लोगों व श्रद्धालुओं और पर्यटकों को भी मिल सके, साथ ही सरकार की आय में भी वृद्धि हो सके। थैंक यू।
सर, वी आर आल्सो एसोसिएट्स।
यस, प्लीज टेक ऑल द एसोसिएट्स। श्री ए के सेल्वराज।
थैंक यू सर।
एक्सपेंशन ऑफ प्लेटफॉर्म एडमिट टू पार्लियामेंट एंड इंट्रोड्यूस and an introduction and extraction termination of train from Mettupalayam. Presently, the platform at Mettupalayam railway station can accommodate train with only 13 coaches maximum. Therefore, there is an urgent need to expand. It is an accommodate train with at least 24 coaches. In the absence of the bigger platform, the Mettupalayam Chennai Nilagiri Express start from Mettupalayam with only 13 coaches and 11 more coaches are attached at Coimbatore railway station, including with the general unreserved coaches. This causes lot of inconvenience of the people of Mettupalayam in the absence of general unreserved coaches. This station also does not have a much required fit line for the maintenance of engine coaches. There is a phase available for the same at this station. The following train starts are terminated at Coimbatore, since Mettupalayam is the last destination of the foothill of Nilgiri Mountains and is closer to the famous tourist place Ooty. There is always a mud rush to Mettupalayam in all seasons. Therefore, it is a requested that the following trains be extended or terminated at Mettupalayam. Charan Express, which presently runs between Coimbatore and Chennai, Coimbatore be extended to Mettupalayam. Coimbatore Mangalore Intercity Express to extended to Mettupalayam. Mettupalayam Mangalore fast passenger to be extended to Mettupalayam. Amirda Express running between Palakkad and Thiruvananthapuram to be extended to Mettupalayam. The people have been demanding for introduction of new passenger train between Mettupalayam and Pollachi, Mettupalayam Bangalore, a new passenger train between Mettupalayam and Coimbatore, and for an additional run of existing passenger running between Mettupalayam and Coimbatore because of huge passenger traffic to all these places from Mettupalayam. The passenger train between Mettupalayam and Coimbatore does not run on Sunday, and the peoples are facing huge hardship between this. Therefore, this train should also be made run on Sunday too. Another demands of the people is stoppage of the passenger train running between Mettupalayam to Coimbatore at Veeravandi, Pudupudur and Thudiyalur because of large number of passengers from to these places. Therefore, I urge upon the Honorable Minister to look into the above and direct the Southern Railway to implement the above demands of the earliest. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Srimati Kannimoji.
Thank you, sir. Tamil Nadu is facing an urgent drought-like situation which has led to poor agricultural productivity, rural distress, acute shortage of drinking water and fodder. For three consecutive years, 2011, 12 and 13, the state has been reeling under drought, having received below normal rainfall. In 2013, both the northeast and the southwest monsoons failed. As per the warnings of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the El Nino effect over the Indian subcontinent will be severe this year. Already the monsoons have arrived late, thus creating a crisis situation in the state. Acute water scarcity across the state has curtailed the cultivation of short-term crops. Perennial crops such as areca plantations have also withered for want of water. Unable to bear crop loss and meet obligations of repaying crop loan, farmers have ended their lives. According to Kaveri Delta Farmers Protection Association, since 2012, more than 13 farmers have committed suicide in Delta districts owing to crop failure following water scarcity. The state is also witnessing an acute shortage of drinking water, with the situation being deplorable in remote tribal hamlets. Therefore, I appeal to the government to declare Tamil Nadu as a drought-hit state and help farmers get the required relief on time. I also urge the government to provide a waiver in the crop loans to the farmers. Since water scarcity is a recurrent issue in my state, I urge the Agriculture Ministry and the Rural Development Ministry to promote research and development of drought-resistant crop varieties, particularly paddy. Thank you, sir.
Okay, take all the associates, please. Shri T. Rathinavel.
Mike associate.
They all.
Transfer of slum encroached lands belonging to the center to Tamil Nadu for slum upgradation program. During the recent conclave of ministers of housing and urban development of states and union territories held in New Delhi, it was decided to achieve the objective of slum free cities before 2023. The government of Tamil Nadu, under the able leadership of our Honorable Chief Minister Purachi Thalavi Amma, has been tirelessly working on providing a dignified living to slum dwellers through various schemes. In this connection, the Tamil Nadu government has urged the center to transfer its lands encroached by slums to implement the slum upgradation program. The state had also demanded that the share of schemes under the Rajiv Awas Yojana be sanctioned based on the proposals of Slum Free Cities program. It has also been suggested to the center that the sanctioning process must be delegated to a state level committee. Tamil Nadu government has further suggested an exclusive housing scheme for tenants living on rent in slum hutments, because tenants living in slum houses for rent also require houses under the Rajiv Awas Yojana. Since the hut owners cannot share their accommodation with tenants, for holistic slum upgradation, an exclusive housing scheme may be formulated as relocation schemes. To attain the objective of slum-free cities, it has also been urged upon the union government to immediately launch a massive urban development program with substantially higher central share of funding after correcting the discrepancies of the old Janurum scheme. I appeal to the center to transfer its lands encroached by slums to Tamil Nadu government for implementing the slum upgradation program. Thank you.
Thank you. Shri P. Rajiv.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Chairman. Kerala is the first state in India which recognized homeopathy as a system of medicine in 1928. In 1943, homeopathy got included in the Travancore Medical Practitioners Act. In 1953, the TC Act was extended to the Malabar area through Kerala adoption routes. The first elected government of the state, headed by EMS Nambudiripad, started a homeopathy dispensary under government sector, which is first time in India. A separate directorate of homeopathy was formed in 1973, first time in India. There is a Center Research Institute at Kurunji, started in 1974. The center was declared as Homeopathic Research Center exclusively for behavioral disorders and epilepsy in 1988. So Kerala is the right place to establish All India Institute for Homeopathy. As per the 12th plan, Government of India has a plan to establish All India Institute of Homeopathy to fulfill the emerging interest of scientists for research in homeopathy. So I urge the government to establish AIH in Kerala. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Shri Motilal Vora. Absent. Shri Anil Desai. Shri Avinash Pandey.
Sir, this is regarding the demand to take immediate measures to provide access to crop insurance to farmers of Vidarbha. Sir, the Vidarbha region is excessively prone to the risk of uncertain monsoon. After being warned of likely 55% deficit in seasonal rainfall, the entire region is now suffering due to incessant excessive rainfall over the past 2-3 days. The crops in the region are mostly rain-fed and access to irrigation facility is limited. The development of irrigation project is a time-consuming program, and farmers in the region continue to suffer in the meanwhile and remain prone to severe losses due to erratic monsoon pattern. Recently, the Agro-Meteorology Department issued an advisory recommending that farmers should refrain from the sowing of BT cotton, which is the most important cash crop yielding relatively higher income of farmers. Intercropping and cultivation of soybean, sunflower and bajra were suggested instead. However, such a shift will cause a substantial decline in the farmers' income, exposing them to great economic insecurity. Concrete measures are required to insulate farmers from the insecurity of high-risk agriculture activity in Vidarbha on priority basis. Therefore, I humbly urge you to take immediate measures to provide wide access to crop insurance scheme to the farmers in furtherance of the government's mission for financial inclusion. Thank you.
Sir, thank you.
Associate.
Yeah, please include all the associates. Shri, yeah, they all included. Shri Mahendra Singh Mehra.
Sir.
Mara.
Sir, Chin desh ke uttari seema Ladakh se भारतीय सीमा पर कई बार अंदर तक घुसपैठ कर चुका है और किसी न किसी बहाने सीमाओं पर तनाव पैदा करता आ रहा है। 1950 में केंद्र सरकार ने उत्तराखंड में टनकपुर पिथौरागढ़ सड़क का निर्माण किया। बाद में रक्षा महत्व की आवश्यकता को देखते हुए इस सड़क को तवाघाट तक बढ़ाया गया, जिसकी जिम्मेदारी लोक निर्माण विभाग को दी गई। लेकिन जुलाई 1963 में इस सड़क से संबंधित कार्य सीमा सड़क संगठन BRO को दिया गया, लेकिन BRO अपने दायित्व का निर्वहन करने में सफल नहीं रहा। 51 सालों के बाद भी BRO 258 किलोमीटर सड़क का निर्माण पूरा नहीं कर सका। यदि भविष्य में युद्ध की आशंका रही तो हम अपनी सेना को चीन सीमा तक नहीं भेज पाएंगे, क्योंकि हमारे पास सड़क नहीं होगी। जबकि चीन ने भारतीय सीमा से लगे तिब्बत की राजधानी लासा, जो 16,440 फुट की ऊंचाई पर है, वहां रेल पहुंचा दी है। सरकार ने हाल ही इस मोटर मार्ग को राष्ट्रीय राजमार्ग घोषित किया है। इसका निर्माण राष्ट्रीय राजमार्ग मंत्रालय द्वारा होना है। मंत्रालय द्वारा तात्कालिक रूप से इसका निर्माण कार्य BRO को ही दिया गया है, जिससे इस मार्ग के पूर्ण होने में संदेह पैदा होता है, क्योंकि जो एजेंसी 51 साल में मोटर मार्ग का निर्माण पूरा नहीं कर सकी, उस पर शंका होना स्वाभाविक है। मेरा आग्रह है कि टनकपुर तवाघाट सड़क का निर्माण पूरा करने के लिए BRO की समय सीमा निश्चित की जाए, अन्यथा इसको पूरा करने में और 51 वर्ष का समय लग सकता है। जैसा कि BRO ने कहा है कि मेरे प्रश्न के उत्तर में, इसका निर्माण 2019 में पूरा होगा, जिसकी कोई गारंटी नहीं है। अतः मेरा इस सदन के माध्यम से माननीय मंत्री जी से आग्रह है कि BRO को स्पष्ट आदेश दिए जाएं कि टनकपुर पिथौरागढ़ तवाघाट मोटर मार्ग का शीघ्र निर्माण करें, जो कि देश की सुरक्षा से जुड़ा हुआ है। थैंक यू।
Associate. Yeah, we'll include all the associates. All the associates are included. Please. Shrimati Gun. TDP. Mahila ko aage bolne dijiye thode aaram se.
I request to introduce Hindi from first standard in government schools of Telangana State and as well as Andhra Pradesh. Three language formula was formulated by Government of India in consultation with the states in 1968 National Policy Resolution and reiterated it under National Policy on Education in 1986. It emphasized that children in Hindi speaking states are to be taught three languages, Hindi, English and local languages, and in one non-Hindi speaking states, the languages of English, Hindi and the local language has to be taught. The issue is, in undivided AP is governed by AP Study of Languages in School Education Rules 2003, framed under AP Education Act 1982. Rule 2 provides that in pursuance of three language formula, students are mandated to study Hindi as second language from 6th to 10th Telugu and English medium schools. Hindi being the official language of the country and largest spoken language in the Indian subcontinent, learning Hindi language from early childhood will immensely benefit school-going children and enable them to converse freely and fluently in Hindi. I am glad that private schools in Telangana state are teaching Hindi language from first standard. I understand that many states in the country introduced Hindi from first standard itself. But in states like AP and Telangana, Hindi is taught only from sixth standard in government and aided schools, resulting in keeping students from these schools as disadvantageous position when compared to students who are studying in private schools where Hindi starts from first standard itself. In view of the above, I request HRD Ministry and Government of India to immediately take steps to teach Hindi from first standard in schools of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll include the associates, please. Shri Ali Anwar Ansari.
Shukriya. Mahoday, jab se Grameen Vikas evam Sadak Parivahan tatha Rajmarg Shipping Mantri ne Ganga Nadi mein har 100 kilometer ki duri par baraj banane ki baat shuru ki hai, tab se Ganga jeevi karodon logon mein ghabrahat phailne lagi hai. गंगा की उड़ाही की बात तो ठीक है लेकिन बराजों की श्रृंखला खड़ी करके गंगा की प्राकृतिक उड़ाही की प्रक्रिया को बाधित करना सूझबूझ की बात नहीं है. महोदय 1971 में पश्चिम बंगाल में फरक्का बराज बना और 1975 में इसकी कमीशनिंग हुई. जब यह बराज नहीं था तो हर साल बरसात के तेज पानी की धारा के कारण 150 से 200 फीट गहराई तक प्राकृतिक रूप से गंगा नदी की उड़ाही हो जाती थी. जब से फरक्का बराज बना सिल्ट उड़ाही की यह प्रक्रिया रुक गई और नदी का तल ऊपर उठता गया. इससे सहायक नदियां भी बुरी तरह प्रभावित हुई हैं. जब नदी की गहराई कम होती है तो पानी फैलता है और कटाव तथा बाढ़ के प्रकोप की तीव्रता बढ़ जाती है. मालदा फरक्का से होकर बिहार के सोनपुर तक ही नहीं बल्कि बनारस तक इसका दुष्प्रभाव देखा जा सकता है. महोदय फरक्का बराज के कारण समुद्र से मछलियों की आवाजाही रुक गई. फीस लैडर बालू मिट्टी से भर गया. झींगा जैसी मछलियों की ब्रीडिंग समुद्र के खारे पानी में होती है जबकि हिलसा जैसे मछलियों का प्रजनन ऋषिकेश के ठंडे मीठे पानी में होता है. अब यह सब प्रक्रिया रुक गई है. गंगा तथा उसकी सहायक नदियों में 80% मछलियां समाप्त हो गई हैं. इससे लोगों के भोजन में प्रोटीन की कमी हो गई. पश्चिम बंगाल बिहार और उत्तर प्रदेश में अब रोजाना आंध्र प्रदेश से मछली आती है. इसके साथ ही मछली से जीविका चलाकर भर पेट भोजन चलाने वाले लाखों मछुआरों के रोजगार समाप्त हो गए हैं. अतः हम सरकार से मांग करते हैं कि गंगा पर नए सिरे से बराजों की श्रृंखला खड़ी करने का विचार त्याग दिया जाए वरना सरकार को जनता के भारी विरोध का सामना करना पड़ेगा. थैंक यू महोदय.
थैंक यू. Please include all the associates. The House stands adjourned to meet on Friday, the 1st August 2014 at 1100 hours.